Today, if you have your Bibles, I want you to turn with me to Matthew's Gospel, chapter 24. Matthew's Gospel, chapter 24. And Jesus has been teaching, and he's been teaching his disciples. And he comes up with this, and he says, "But as the days of Noah were," in verse 37, "but as the days of Noah were, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. For as in the days that were before the flood, there were eating, drinking, marrying, and giving in marriage, until the day that Noah entered into the ark, and knew not until the flood came and took them all away, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be." Jesus responded to these words to his disciples right after they asked him a question: when will the end come? When will the end come? It's a good question. And he began to state as the days of Noah. So that's my topic this morning, the days of Noah. Jesus here compared the days of Noah to the last days in which he will return. The return of Christ will come upon mankind suddenly and unexpectedly, as it did with the great flood. And the Lord compared the characteristics of those days to that of men at the time of his return. In verse 38, we read these words once again: "For as in the days there were before the flood, they were eating, drinking, marrying, giving in marriage, until the day Noah entered into the ark." Now, there's something we can learn from the days of Noah that will keep us attuned to when the Lord is returning, and that will help us triumphant in the time we find ourselves living in. Now, Peter called the days of Noah a time of God's long suffering. In 1 Peter 3:20, we'll find which sometimes were disobedient. We once the long-suffering of God waited in the days of Noah, while the ark was being prepared within a few, that is, eight souls were saved by the water. Now, God is long-suffering means that God, amen, is waiting. Waiting for men and women, boys and girls, to respond to His calling. I believe that God gives everyone an opportunity to accept Him as their Lord and Savior of their life. And while He is long-suffering, He is waiting, and the message is going out. And whether you receive that message or not is up to you. Jesus died on the cross because He loved the world. He died there on that cross for every mankind. Every one of us. He died for you and I. Why did He die for us? Because He loved us. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son. And He's not willing that any should perish, but all come to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. As Noah began to build the ark, it took him a while to do that because he's never built a boat. He never seen a boat. But he built that ark as God gave him the plan and the detail to do so. And it took him some time, and I believe that each day that he worked on the ark, God was calling some sinner to repentance. God was calling out to mankind in that day, "Come and be in the ark of safety. Come, I want to save you. Come, because there is a terrible judgment on the horizon, and it's coming. God will pour His wrath upon the unregenerated world," amen, "the wicked world. And He's given us an opportunity to repent of our sin." And Peter described this as God's long suffering. The days of Noah were in reality a time of salvation, a time of deliverance, and a time of mercy. Therefore, as we consider the days of Noah with a view to learn something relevant and to help us, let us do so from God's perspective as that of Noah and the men who lived in those days. Their days were evil. Are we living in evil time? The Bible tells us in Ephesians 5:16, redeem the time because the days are evil. And redeeming the time is to make the most of your time. See, every one of us sitting here and listening by means of television or Facebook Live or on the parking lot through whatever means. Listen, friend, we better take advantage of the time allotted for us because we only got a little bit of it. For the book of James and says in 4:14, what is your life but a vapor that appears for a little time and then it's gone. We better not be so focused on the world. We better not be so focused on the world. We better be focused on what is important. That is surrendering our life to Christ before the terrible judgment of His wrath be poured out. There was marriage abuse. Notice what he said again. There was marrying was given in marriage. The sons of God saw the daughters of men. They were fair and they took them wives and of all which they choose. They was using marriage in the wrong fashion. They was using more for the burning lust within them than they were for the love and compassion in their heart for one another. See, Jesus is love, isn't He? For God is love. And His love is not consumed by lust. It's an unconditional love. A love that buys for eternity. And that's the kind of love that we should have one for another. Friend, our love should be unconditionally love, just as Christ's love for you and I. It was a time of polygamy where there was men were marrying more than one wife. How many women did God create for Adam? I only can find one. One man, one woman for a lifetime. But they decided since their lust was consuming them, they would go ahead and marry multiple wives. My God, they was asking for a heartache, won't they? There was wicked rule there. There were giants in the earth in those days. And also after that, when the sons of God came unto the daughters of men, they bare children to them. The same became mighty men, which were of old men of renown, mighty warriors and famous. It was a time of might makes right. Whatever feels good, let's do it. We are living in that type of world right now. We are living where people are evil, don't respect one another, don't honor one another. Don't honor the marriage. Don't honor respect. And then we go on down and they're wicked. Because they do evil, they think everybody else should do evil. And now they're taking right and making it wrong. And making wrong right. But in God's sight, amen, God has set the standards of what's right and wrong. And we can't alter those. We can try. We can try to do it our own way. But our way will end up in the judgment that was before Noah. The judgment that the rain was going to destroy the world and all the wickedness therein. Friend, today God said it won't be water but fire the next time. You better be prepared because His wrath is coming once again upon this wicked world. Violence prevailed in that day. What do we see now? We see violence all over across the land. We see folks blocking our businesses and keeping folks from going in and banging their cars and hitting them and knocking them in the head for even walking down the street. This is nothing but pure evil and violence acts of unkindness. The Bible tells me in Genesis 6:11, the earth was also corrupt before God and the earth was filled with violence. Friend, we are living in the very days as the days of Noah. And that's what I want you to see today. we're living exactly what God said would happen before he returned. Men was corrupt. Because in Genesis 6:12 it said, God looked upon the earth and behold, it was corrupt. For all flesh had corrupted his ways upon the earth. Evil men waxed worse. In 2 Timothy 3:12 it tells us, yea, and all that will live godly in Christ shall suffer persecution. Friend, because of men's corruptness and evil, Christians are being persecuted today. If not, just turn on your television. Listen to how the churches are being prosecuted today in this time of pandemic that we find ourselves in. They don't want us to come together and worship like we are today. They want us to refrain from serving God. And they will prosecute you, amen, and persecute you for that very reason. Here in America, we used to hear about it in distant lands, but now it's come to roost at our doorstep. Why? Because men are corrupt and evil. And when men are corrupt and evil and wicked and living in the way that we're living today in these evil days, it grieves God. That day of Noah grieved God. Why? Because it was a world of ungodliness. In 2 Peter 2:5, Peter says this, and spare not the old world, but save Noah and 8 persons, a preacher of righteousness, bringing in the flood upon the world of the ungodly. How many people made it to the door of the ark? Only Noah and his family. 8 people out of the entire world was saved during the destruction of the first wrath of God poured out upon an evil generation. 8 people. Think about how many is going to heaven today. The Bible says there's only a few that will find that straight and narrow path. Only a few, as it was in the days of Noah. I hope it's more than 8. And I pray that it's more than 8. And I pray that you're ready because it's going to come. They told Noah he was crazy. You might say I'm crazy. But it's going to come. God's judgment is coming. And it might be sooner than we think because it's going to come suddenly and unexpectedly. It grieved God. Because they were dark days. And 2 Timothy warns us that also in the last days, perilous times will come. Troubling days shall come. But evil men and seducers shall wax worse and worse and deceiving and being deceived. 2 Timothy 3:13. The word of God was rejected. The word of God is being rejected today. 1 Peter 3:20 tells us, which sometimes were disobedient, and once the long-suffering of God waited in the days of Noah while the ark was being prepared, within a few, that is 8 souls saved. 8 souls did not reject God's word. Were saved. Did you get that? Sin conquered in that time. Sin is conquering today. Let's be honest. Sin has got the upper hand at this moment in time. Sin conquers the world and it conquers the religious institutions. Think about the churches that compromise God's word for the cultural beliefs. Think about the churches that compromise the truth of this book for cultural beliefs. Cultural beliefs are man's beliefs. And whenever we lean toward man's belief, we sin. And sin is ungodliness. It's sin. And sin conquers the church. The church has no influence upon the world because it became too much like the world. The Bible says we as believers are to be peculiar people, and we need to come out from the world's belief and circumstances and live separately. Be ye separate, said the Lord. Touch not and handle not the uncleanness of this world. So where are we today as a church, as a whole? We're right in the midst of the mess. We can't distinguish the world from the church any longer. When the church should be peculiar, there should be something peculiar about the believers of God. It was one time in America that the church was the greatest influence, amen. It was the greater light, amen, to the darkness of our world and generations. But it's no longer there. Why? Because sin conquered the world and the church. And God saw that the wickedness of men was great in the earth, and that every imagination and thoughts of hearts were only evil, and it continually, 6:5 in Genesis. In Romans 1:18, it says this, and I'll read on from there. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who holds the truth in unrighteousness. Because that which may be known of God is manifested in them, for God has showed it unto them. For the invisible things of Him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by these things, they are made, even in His eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. Because that, when they knew God, they glorified Him not as God, neither were thankful, but became vain in their imagination, and their foolish heart was darkened. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools. And they changed the glory of the uncorruptible God into an image made like unto corruptible men, and to birds and four-footed beasts and creeping things. Listen to what he said. Wherefore God also gave them up to uncleanness through the lust of their own hearts to dishonor their own bodies between themselves, who changed the truth of God into a lie and worship and serve the creature more than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. For this cause God gave them up to vile affection, for even their women did change the natural use into which is against nature. And likewise also the men, leaving the natural use of the woman, burned in their lust, one toward another, men with men, working that which is unseemly, and receiving in themselves that recompense of their error which was meant. And even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a reprobate mind to do those things which were not convenient, being filled with all unrighteousness and fornication and wickedness and covetousness and maliciousness, full of envy, murder, debate, deceit, malignant, whisperers, backbiters, haters of God, despiteful, proud, boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents, without understanding, covenant breakers, without natural affections, unmerciful, who knowing the judgment of God that which commits such things are worthy of death, not only do the same, but have pleasure in them that do them. God put it very plainly, very simple, and very outlined there in that. The thing that we are living in, folks, amen, we see happening, amen, in this world today. The very thing that he explained here is where our world is today. Look, men with men, women with women, he says that right here in this verse. You know, he's saying, hey, look, that's not natural. It's not of God. And he said right there in the last verse, in verse 32, who knowing the judgment of God, they which commit to doing these things are worthy of death. But he says not only those who commit those, but those who have pleasure in them. What do we see? Over the news, you hear very little about it. What about all these children they've been finding, the U.S. Marshals have been finding, and sex trafficking across the United States of America? Was 100 and some children in Michigan. I think it was 30 some in Georgia. God help us, folks. We are on the verge of seeing God's almighty wrath poured upon us. If we don't repent of our sins and turn from our wicked ways, amen, we're going to suffer the consequences. And it's not going to be pretty. Those folks in Noah's days ignored God, did what they wanted to do. until the first raindrop came, and then they wanted to repent of their sin, but it was too late. God gave you an opportunity, and He's given you an opportunity today. And if you wait till tomorrow, it may be too late. For what is your life but a vapor? And tomorrow is not promised. Today is a day of salvation. Today is a day of repentance. And God, amen, I believe He instilled that, amen, when Noah was preaching, to tell them that today is the day, not tomorrow. You won't be here tomorrow. God's judgment and wrath is going to be poured out. And it ain't going to be pretty. And why did I say that? Because I read the back of the book. And it said when God returns for His church and it is raptured out of here. And I know there are some listening to me who is going to debate me whether rapture is really in the Bible or not. But call away is the same thing as rapture. Call away. In 1 Thessalonians 4:13, we're going to be called away, honey. The church is going out of here. And that's when God is going to unleash, amen, His wrath upon a wicked and perverse generation. It's called the tribulation period if you hadn't heard about it. It's called the tribulation period. It's 7 years where God will pour plagues upon plagues. You think you've seen something with this little pandemic? You ain't seen nothing yet. You ain't seen nothing what's coming. And folks, amen, you better take heed because it's right around the corner. We're seeing natural disasters, one right after the other. We are seeing earthquakes in different places. And I ain't never seen the weather like it's been in the last 10 years. Around here, we never had a tornado. But we can expect the tornado to hit any time. Why? Because God is setting things up, amen, for the wrath of God to be poured out. And you better get ready. And you better bear it in mind. Because God showed Noah the rainbow sign. And He said it won't be the water, but it's going to be a fire the next time. Fire the next time. I don't know about you, but I want to be ready because the results are horrifying. Think about those folks, amen, in Noah's days. Have you ever seen a person drown? But I don't know about that. I wouldn't want to see it. But Noah probably heard them drowning and dying. Friend, I don't want to hear that. When the fire starts to pour down from the earth. Amen. Fire and brimstone. I think about, they say in there that a comet may hit the earth right before election day. My gosh, I say, you know, that's fire. And think about what a comet will do, what the scientist tells us that it would do if it hit the earth. Fire and brimstone. We're just one step away. I've been burnt. Have you been burnt? I had second and third degree burns one time. It wasn't pretty. But think about that terrible day. Why would God do that, preacher? Because of the wickedness in the hearts of men. He'll show them who's God. When they don't even like to acknowledge God. That's what He said in Romans, didn't it? They didn't like to acknowledge God. He'll tell them who's in control. It's not you and I. It's not you and I. God's in control. We think we are. And that's where our problem is. When we start thinking we are in control. God's in control. I can't even bat my eye without God. I can't even get out of bed without God. I can't even be standing before you without God. It's God, amen? It's not us. We're not some mighty men. Boy, I tell you what, when you take a look around, look at you and I today. We might be poor, we might be rich, but all of us are the same. We got a soul that's given by God. God is going to come back for that soul. That soul better be ready, amen? That soul better had made up its mind that it wants to serve God. There's two ways that we can go, to the left or to the right. The left is the evilness of the world and the pleasures of the world. What would a man give in exchange for his soul? I talked to Bob and Mr. Prophet about this morning. What would a man give in exchange for his soul, the Bible says? What shall it profit a man if he should gain the whole world and lose his own soul? You know, he said, what would a man give in exchange for his soul? You ever thought about that question? What would you give in exchange for your soul? Your soul is going to leave your body. And your choices that you made while it was in the body determines your eternal destination. The choice to do the left or the right, the world and all its pleasures. If you had somebody to offer you that today, all the pleasures of the world, man, you could live in the biggest mansion that is. You could have all the benefits of it, and you could have all the money you can spend, all the things you ever want. Would you exchange it for your soul? Many would, because of the love of money is the root of all evil, isn't it? The love of money. Having money isn't wrong, but when it becomes the priority in your life, that's when it becomes wrong. You get in the picture? What would a man give in exchange? Because we all going to die. The rich man is going to die. Jesus gave an illustration of Lazarus and the poor man and the rich man. The rich man fared sumptuously every day. He had the pleasures of this life. The poor man, he didn't have it. He was thanking God he could survive one day from the next. One day to the next, he was thankful. But then all of a sudden, both of them died. And Jesus said, in hell, the rich man lifted up his eyes because he exchanged all the pleasures of the world for his soul. The rich man in hell lifted up his eyes, being in torment by the flames of hell. You think being burned up on earth is bad? Wait till you spend eternity, your soul in a flame of fire. A fire that's never quenched, never quits. But the poor man who fared from day to day, barely making it, but he had made a choice to give God his heart, was in heaven, Abraham's bosom. And being comfort, being taken care of, what the rich man sold his soul for here on earth, the poor man now gains in heaven. Why? Because he knows God owned it all. God owned it all. So how will you go? Would you exchange your soul for the world and its pleasures as the men and women in the days of Noah did? And in the days that we're living in are doing? Or will you turn to the right? The righteous, the morals, and all the standards that God's laid out in His Word for you and I to follow. The choice is ours. Choose wisely, because your choice that you make will lead to your eternal destiny.